Amen. Praise the Lord. He shall be my shelter. Amen. What about these young people who came up here? Amen. Praise the Lord. We are glad to be here. It was, and I do apologize for getting here at the time that I did, but I did have some urgent things that I needed to take care of. I told the pastor, but God is an on-time God.
Amen.
Amen. The road were clear. Amen. And I didn't have to go over the speed limit.
Amen.
Amen. I don't go too much over the speed limit anyway. Amen. 3 or 4 miles, something like that. Any officers here? Amen. Praise the Lord. First of all, I want to thank Pastor for this opportunity to come and to share with you. He's not only my friend, but he is also like a pastor's pastor to me. Amen. And I really appreciate him. I love him. We talk often. And it's just amazing how so many great things are done in this church and in this community because of this ministry. And we thank God for that. Amen. Amen. And I enjoy your Christmas singing, talking tree, and all of that because it's different and it's fresh, but it's good. Amen. So praise the Lord. Amen. Let us have a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, in the precious name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity. And Lord, we thank you for the words that have already been preached, Lord, and the words that will be preached coming forward, going forward. Lord, thank you for this pastor, this church, all of the dwelling churches here, Lord. And most of all, Lord, thank you for Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, we give you thanks and help us, Lord, as we not only hear the word, but let us be able to do your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, we've come to the fifth word, and I just want to say that I know that the table has been set because you have heard 4 great words. Amen. I know you did. I heard part of the 4th word, and I'm going to tell you, Reverend, the Lord is using you mightily. I haven't heard you preach in a long time, but amen. Praise the Lord. It's just, I like that. Amen. But that's a new ministry for me, new witnessing. Well, I go around, I'm going to go like this. This means the cross.
Amen.
We all make mistakes. No matter how small or great, we all make mistakes. We may not be aware of all the mistakes we make, but we do make mistakes. However, the suffering and death of Jesus Christ was no mistake. Jesus' death was planned and the mission was accomplished. He died. Before Jesus died, he said, I thirst. When Jesus stated he thirsted, the question is, what was the request? What was this? Was it a request or a prayer? If the words of Jesus, what he spoke, was a request, then it was for the ears of men who could not quench Jesus' thirst. But if it was a statement of the words, I thirst, not as a request, but as a prayer, then it was for the ears of his God and his Father, who is able to quench the thirst of everyone. Jesus said, I thirst. Because men and women needed to receive a revelation from the cross that Jesus was truly a human being. Jesus' death was not only planned, but also his birth was planned. Yet Jesus was not just born to die, Jesus was born to save us from our sins. Jesus was born to redeem us. He was born to liberate us. He was born to deliver us. He was born to glorify himself in us. He was born to dwell in us, to justify us, to regenerate us, to empower us, to give us strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. He has done it and he is doing it. I'm a witness that God can turn any situation He thirsted for our salvation. He said, I thirst. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. After this, after what? After what he had already said. But something else needed to be said in order for this thing that needed to be fulfilled. He needed to say, I thirst. Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. Jesus, knowing creatively and divinely, this proves that he is omniscient, which means that he knows all things and he knows everything. He knew when it was going to happen. He knew why it was going to happen. He knew how it was going to happen, but he came and did it anyway. Even though he said, Father, will you let this cup pass by me? But he said, not my will, but your will be done. That's what I call obedience. Jesus came and he died in the spirit of obedience to the Father. Jesus, knowing that he was dying and that he was dying for a purpose of obedience to fulfill the Father's will. God proved that his knowledge was divine, the divineness of the Son. And it is our blessing that we are all to be made image in the image of the Son, to be fulfilled being like the Son. Romans 8:29, that we come into that, because without that we don't have a future. I'm glad that Jesus died for our sins. God proved that his knowledge was not only divine and anointed, but the knowledge is for all knowledge. The evidence of the Trinity is dying on a cross. It is God himself in the body of Jesus dying on the cross. His character proves the fact that Jesus is fully God. The blood came streaming down. Jesus knew the purpose why he was thirsting. Jesus understood that the more blood the body loses, the more the body becomes thirsty. Of course, the body becomes thirsty when too much fluid is lost at one time. To realize all of this is to remember Leviticus chapter 17 and verse 11, for the life of the flesh is in the blood. Oh, hallelujah, glory be to God. The fulfillment of the atonement was on the cross. Jesus is the atonement. Without the atonement, we have no hope. He takes the place of the mercy seat. The mercy seat was there, but now the atonement. And he's on his way to the Holy of Holies, not into a cave, not into something like that, but into heaven. The real Holy of Holies that he only had to do, he only had to die once. I'm glad that Jesus doesn't have to come back again and finish the job, because it is already done. That's for the next preacher that's coming up. Amen. But here it is something that he is the atonement. The atonement is dying on a cross. The ultimate price for our salvation on a cross is the Day of Atonement. And the atoner had to die for our sins. It was no surprise that Jesus, who is the atonement, that he would shed his blood for us as the divine Savior. Yet, he was human and all that, but taking on a divine role, because he is both fully human and fully God. So the only word of the seven words that's spoken in the humanity to really see the flesh come to a real need is I thirst. The God who created us thirsts. The God who loves us, the God who said that, the God who calmed the seas thirsts. And so here, for a while, it is the Spirit that comes into the body, dwells in the body. That's how we are saved. When we worship God, we're not worshiping God outside of God's Spirit. We are worshiping God with His Spirit. In other words, God is worshiping Himself through us. And when God talks to Himself, it's God talking to God. And we get a chance to get in on the conversation here. So the shortest of the seven words is I thirst. After losing so much blood, he is thirsty. Going from judgment. nothing, but knowing now that all things are accomplished. Oh, that's something that we dwell on. We rejoice when we can accomplish something. When you accomplish something, you don't just be still and just walk away from it. You may clap your hands. You may go into a little dance. You'll smile. You'll tell somebody else. But if you've been through a struggle, a bitter struggle, and you have come through as pure gold, you're going to tell somebody. That's what I call a testimony. When you don't have and you couldn't get, and God seemed to be far off, but then one day there's a breakthrough in your life, and God accomplished it in your life, you've got to shout glory, because it didn't have to happen. Some of us may have had problems paying our rent and our mortgage. Some of us may have problems paying hospital bills, but let Jesus handle it. He will accomplish it. On that cross, no one can take his life. Hallelujah. They couldn't break his bones because it was not in the scripture for his bones to be broken. So he died. But before he died, everything that needed to be accomplished was accomplished. Our God is a complete God. He'll accomplish it. Don't worry if you are having trouble living a Christian life. Stay with Jesus. Stay with Jesus. Stay with Jesus, because he's a complete God. Ah, hallelujah. God is not finished with us yet. There is still some accomplishments that God wants to do in us. Jesus on the cross. Jesus, hallelujah, on the cross. But he stayed there. All the pain he endured, he stayed there. Aren't you glad for a staying God? He doesn't run away from us when we're going through something. He'll open doors that no one can shut, and shut doors that no one can open. Do I have a witness? Do I have a witness? I need a stronger witness than that. Do I have a witness that God is the accomplishing God? Aren't you glad? Some things you couldn't have before, but you got them now. Well, I'm so glad that I watched the television the other day. And so all those young people in Washington and in Seattle, Washington, New York, and all of that, they said, if you won't fight for us, we'll fight for ourselves. We'll get out there ourselves. But they were taught how to march. They were taught by Dr. King and those who became those who were before Dr. King and after Dr. King. They learned how to march. Don't tell me that marching won't do anything. It will do something. It'll draw attention all out there from every culture, if you will. I'm telling you that God is an accomplisher. He will accomplish. Anybody here got the victory? By faith, you got the victory. By faith, you got the victory. Because you got the victory. Is there anybody here believe that you got the victory? You may not see it with your physical eye. Jesus said, I thirst. All things were filled. Yeah, I'm so glad. I'm so glad that it was filled. Yeah. And I don't know what to do. Some of you have been tired. You spent maybe about a couple of weeks or a couple of months not doing much, but then you had to do something else. You had to do something because there's some work in you. Jesus is still working. Yeah, he's still working. Yes. And so he said, I thirst. And by him, the question is, because here, and I'll be finished in just about 40 seconds. They make that a minute 40 seconds. He was on the cross and he said, I thirst. Not that he wanted something from them who were torturing him, but I thirst. I thirst for God. Anybody here thirst for God? Thirst for the things of God. Thirst to fulfill God.
psalmist said, they gave me gall for my food. And for my thirst, they gave me vinegar to drink. The thing about it at the cross, they kept on tempting him. They didn't just tempt him. They kept on, take it, take it, take it. And Jesus said, I thirst, but they were mistaken. They thought that he was thirsting for that which they had. He already knew what they had. But he was thirsty. He was thirsty because he said, it's time to go home. Anybody here ever been someplace and you just got tired where you were? You just wanted to go home. I want to get in my own bed. It may not feel like this hotel bed, but I want to get in my own bed. I want to cook my own food. I leave you with this. Psalm 42, verses 1 and 2. As the deer pants for the water brooks, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? We know what they gave to Jesus, or what they wanted to give to Jesus, to quench his thirst. And we cannot quench. Man cannot die for man. Man cannot quench Jesus' thirst without Jesus. Because we have the wrong DNA. We have a CBL, a corrupt bloodline. But with the Holy Spirit, because he dwells in us, we can please God. So, my soul thirsts. The question that I ask you now, what are we giving to Jesus?
My Lord.
To quench his thirst. What are you giving to Jesus? To quench his thirst. Amen.